Let's see. Okay, so I also started my recording now. So hopefully we'll have dual recordings now. Today I'll give a bird's eye overview of intervention mapping, which is, as Helena just said, the technique we'll be using throughout the project. I'll keep it really, really brief, so it might be a little bit overwhelming, but it will be recorded, so you can watch back. Plus, everything will come by in the project, so then we can take it a bit more slowly. So, intervention mapping is originally a book. It's been around for about 25 years now. The first book was from the end of the 90s, I think. Now we are up to edition 4. And mostly, that's a bit confusing sometimes to people, but it's a framework. It's not actually a theory. It's kind of like a protocol, but it's not like a checklist of things to do. It basically helps you to make sense of complexity. So the idea is that if you have a problem that you want to solve that somehow involves humans, then intervention mapping can help you to get an overview of everything that's important, figure out what you want to focus on, and think about how to solve the problem. Because of this, it also introduces a lot of words for things that we discuss, that makes it easier to talk to each other about how to approach such problems and about how to think about behavior change, which is eventually what you'll be doing if you try to tackle a problem that deals with humans. One of the problems of our world is that it's complex, which is of course fun and beautiful and rewarding, but also makes solving problems very hard. And one of the challenges there is to not give in to the temptation to make things too simple so that it becomes easy for you, but to actually try to deal with the complexity, but still keep it manageable. And intervention mapping kind of tries to help you to do that. These are some networks that were created by researchers that tried to map all the factors that are important around some kind of issue or problem. And then you quickly see that it becomes very overwhelming. Tina and Helena recently made something similar for the project they did. They told you about the Iedereen on Board, Everybody Aboard project. And that also became pretty overwhelming quite quickly. So as soon as you really start to map out everything you know about something, you quickly end up with a network kind of like this. And you quickly start regretting that you even started. Intervention mapping kind of helps you deal with this using the core processes that are processes that are very core, that are used throughout the intervention mapping project. They were originally only described in the books, which are not for free, but recently Rob and Rick, the dynamic duo, wrote an open access paper, this one, we can send it around later, where they also explain it. Basically, the idea of the core processes is that you start by posing the questions that you have, and that from that point on, they help you to get answers. First, you just think about what you already know. That's unfortunately the phase where most people also stop, but the idea of the core processes is that you also continue. So then you look at what does the world know? So you look into the literature and you look at what kinds of answers did people already find to these kinds of questions when they studied them. Of course, sometimes people might not have found any answers at all or might not even have studied them, but at least then you'll have an overview. Then the fourth step is that you start looking at theories that might help to get an idea about what answers might be. And those theories will generally be more general. They won't apply to your specific problem. But because they are general, they generally describe situations that are similar and they can describe how little bits of the world work. And by looking at those theories, you can get ideas as to which little bits of the world you should look at when you are thinking about your specific problem. And then finally, you try to assess whether you still need to do more research. And if so, you do this. And then you have a list of answers that you know is based on everything you know and the expert you know, everything that humanity found out with research, and everything that we know because we codified it in theories. This little word address does a lot of heavy lifting in this sentence because that basically means do studies. And each of those can, of course, take one or several months. So don't underestimate that step. So one example here, which simultaneously is an example of how important it is to do these studies, is a description of these, the application of these core processes. So basically, when people started thinking about this problem, and this was about condom use among adolescents, they started thinking about why would people adolescents use condoms or not use condoms. And one of the reasons people thought about was that they didn't know enough about HIV and sexually transmittable infections. And that was one of the reasons why they wouldn't use condoms. Then they looked at the empirical literature in the second column, step three. And they looked at what other people found out. So the list became longer. Then they looked at theories that are relevant to behavior. And some other additions were added. And then finally, in step five, they did their own research. And there, only when they looked at the target population and they talked to them, they found out that actually people didn't have a lack of knowledge. So it's very important to actually always look at your target population and talk to them. These theories are very important, basically because they kind of consolidate the knowledge that we, as humanity, humankind, obtain from lots of single studies. And there are different theories that you can use, and you don't have to know all of them, of course. I'm considering whether to get the dog from downstairs or not, but I think I'll leave him for now. Hopefully he goes back to sleep. Maybe not. So there are lots of different theories for specific purposes. And throughout this project, we'll use those when they apply. And there are often different theories for explaining how the world looks versus changing bits of the world. The important thing here is that each of these theories was designed to explain or help change a little bit of the world. So whenever you deal with a real-world problem, you always have to combine multiple theories. And that's one of the things that intervention mapping helps you with. This also kind of makes sense. Like if you look at the complex system at the left, that's complex, with lots of different variables that influence each other. But the theories we use are much simpler. They just have a few boxes and arrows, basically. So it makes sense that you need to combine loads of those to explain any real-world problem you run into. So intervention mapping tries to help you with all this, and to keep it kind of organized, it has six steps. The first step is the needs assessment, which is basically what we're doing now, where you are trying to map the problem. If you give me 1 second, I'll go get the dog, because this is annoying. Here is the little dog. Hey. Okay. Cool. So Shefke is upstairs, still being annoying, but at least now he's not barking anymore. So we can continue. So in the first step, you do the needs assessment, which basically means you look at what exactly is the problem. That's often necessary because when you come into a new problem for the first time, it's quite easy to have the wrong idea about what actually is the thing that needs to change. So by properly looking at the situation and the problem and talking to people, you can get a better grasp on which things in the environment or which behaviors should actually change. Then, when you have a better idea of this, you can start thinking about what actually should change inside people's minds. We'll come back to that later. Then in step three, you start thinking about how you can change those things. From like the past like 100 years of psychological research, we learned a lot about how people learn and therefore how you can support people if they want to reattribute things in their environment or if they want to be less susceptible to social pressure and stuff like that. Then in step four, you wrap everything together into one coherent intervention. And steps five and six are a bit special because they are less linear than steps 1 to 4. Step five is the implementation of the intervention, which is something you have to anticipate on from the beginning, because it's important that already from the beginning, you start talking to the people who will be implementing your program, because they can make sure that you don't make stupid mistakes in the beginning, because you just don't know how things happen in practice. So for example, if you want to develop an intervention for coaches, you can have brilliant ideas, but if you would have included some coaches from the beginning, they could have told you that some of those ideas are just not feasible in practice because they know that people won't do it or people will feel ashamed or there's no time or whatever. So it's important to make sure you include as many important stakeholders from the beginning as possible. That's step five, the implementation. Step six is the evaluation, which for researchers is the most straightforward one, because basically it just means that you evaluate whether the intervention works. And if you did step 1 through 5 pretty much according to the intervention mapping guidelines, then step 6 will be relatively simple, because you already know exactly what to measure and how. So that's a bird's eye overview. Now I'll give a brief summary of why behavior change is so central to intervention mapping. So the idea is you have interventions, and my field is mostly like nightlife related risk behavior. So that's why these are about sex and drugs and rock and roll. And the idea of those interventions is that you want to make people healthy and or happy. And these are usually kind of considered interchangeably. The idea is that if people are healthy, they're generally happier than if they are unhealthy. And you can't directly change people's health or happiness, so you have to work through those people themselves who are in the middle. Specifically, if you want to make sure they are healthier or happier, they have to behave in the right way at the right moment. Because the idea is that to the degree that people control their health and happiness, their health and happiness is a consequence of what they do. And their behavior, basically their muscle activity, is controlled by their central nervous system, which is controlled by their brain. So that basically means that if you want to improve people's health and happiness, you can have to change something in their brain. In their brain, they have the motor cortex, which is a bit at the side. You can't see it now because it's covered by my headset, but it's under there. And the motor cortex controls your motor activity. So it controls your muscles. So it basically controls all your behavior. So that means we only have to find out what we have to change to make sure the right signals are sent to the motor cortex at the right moment. So that's easy. Basically, the brain consists of neurons, which are usually depicted kind of like this. So we ultimately have to figure out which we have to target. But there are a lot of those, like 90 million. Billion, even, in English. So just for some context, we have 200 billion stars in our galaxy. And there are about 7 billion. This is a bit of an old slide. It might even be like 8 billion people at the planet right now. So basically, a lot. And those are connected to, on average, 7,000 other neurons. That's also a lot. So that's basically what you have to deal with. And intervention mapping kind of helps you to do this. But it's a bit more complex even, because this person is not alone. This person is in an environment. They have people around them that influence their behavior. They are in organizations that have stakeholders and decision makers that change their environment. They might be in a community, they're in a society, and the society is in a world. And in this environment, there are also things. There are like people have a lot of money or not so much money. There can be free fruit available or not, etc., etc. So people's environments, controlled by those decision makers at different levels of that environment, also influence people's behaviors. So if we kind of take this all together and we start thinking about how to change this, we start at the end with health and quality of life. And this is determined by people's behavior and by their environment. So if you live in a very toxic environment, then your behavior doesn't matter so much. But of course, you could move, so then behavior does matter. So those two basically determine people's health and quality of life. Now, the cool thing is that these environmental conditions are controlled by somebody in the environment, by politicians, by directors, other decision makers, who again are just people or groups of people. Usually in intervention mapping, if you want to change a behavior, you distinguish sub-behaviors. You call them performance objectives in intervention mapping. So if a behavior is, for example, not bystanding, like proactively bystanding, if you see that there might be like transgression of somebody's personal boundaries, then sub-behaviors might be that people have to decide that they want to do this. They have to recognize the right situation and then actually act. Depending on how the other person responds, they have to do specific things. And each of these sub-behaviors, people can have different reasons for doing those. So each of those sub-behaviors have different so-called determinants, which are the psychological variables that determine their behavior. And of course, for each sub-behavior, the environment is important again. And those environment conditions, so for example, whether there's a lot of support in the environment, whether there are procedures for signaling things, etc., are again under control of decision makers. Those determinants are usually defined at a quite generic level, like knowledge, norms, awareness, attitude. So you have to distinguish the subdeterminants, which are much more specific, like specific advantages of doing a behavior or something like that. Uh, I'll give you some time to process that. To change those subdeterminants, you develop applications, which are specific applications, specific intervention components. For example, materials like a poster or a movie or a protocol or role play or training or whatever. And those target those subdeterminants, those specific ideas people have. And they can work if they implement behavior change principles. And those behavior change principles basically tell us what we have to do to make sure people can learn something, to make sure that those subdeterminants change. And they only work under very specific conditions, which we know and they're listed somewhere, but we can ignore them for now. For the intervention bit, you actually just develop new interventions. For the implementation bit, sorry. So basically, if people have to start doing something different in their daily work, for example, to make sure your intervention keeps being implemented, then those people have to do some behavior change as well. So you just develop a new intervention specifically for those people. Basically, you just keep applying intervention mapping to all these things. I already clicked next. So it should be going to the next slide. It's just really slow. So this is basically the full overview. You start at the right-hand side. If you want to change people's health and quality of life, then the idea is this is a consequence of people's behavior and environmental conditions. Behaviors consist of sub-behaviors, and those sub-behaviors are also the consequence of environmental conditions, but those environmental conditions are under the control of decision makers, stakeholders in the environment, who are, again, people or groups of people who, again, do things for reasons, which means you can change those. And why people do things is described in psychological theories. So we know that there are different types of so-called determinants, which consist of specific subdeterminants. This stuff, if you have mapped all this stuff out, you can start changing things. The reason this works is, sorry that it's so slow. It's basically hidden inside all these brain cells that we have. Because the point is that you have less and less brain cells the older you get. And that's because you can learn. Learning basically manifests as your brain retaining useful connections. So basically, you have lots of brain cells. They have lots of connections. They make new connections all the time. But those that are somehow useful are retained. Those that are useless, those connections that you can't really use for anything, drop out. It's kind of like evolution almost. There's just random stuff being created all the time, but there's some selection pressure so that less and less is retained. And that's learning. And that's why throughout your life you lose brain cells and you basically become more efficient. Less flexible, but more efficient. One of these learning processes is habituation, which is basically the process that organisms, like humans, learn that there are some things that don't matter to them, so you can ignore them. So hopefully one day I'll have that with Shevka. When he starts barking, I just don't hear it anymore. And it's only you people who are annoyed by him. So that's also why some people can live close to train stations or airports, because at some point they just don't hear the vehicles anymore. Operant conditioning is another. Basically, when you punish or reward behaviors, they can increase or decrease in frequency. Procedural memory is the ability of organisms to connect little tasks into one big chunk. For example, riding a bicycle or tying your shoelaces. And vicarious learning is one that we use a lot. That was the first learning process that evolved that allows organisms to learn through observing other organisms. Before that, everybody had to learn everything for themselves, to trial and error, which of course is tricky if you have to learn that something can kill you. Vicarious learning means learning through others, through observing others. That was the first time that a learning process evolved where organisms could just watch other organisms, and when something happened to them, they could learn from it. So I made a brief animation. I'm not sure whether it survived the streaming, but let's see. So he's dead now, which is very sad for Barney, that one's called, I think. But now, because Barney made this terrible sacrifice, and he even looks quite happy about it, Fred Flintstone knows that he shouldn't go into the bush. And that's vicarious learning. before vicarious learning evolved, Fred Flintstone would have just gone into the bush, because he wouldn't have realized that, of course, what happened to Barney might happen to him. And there are, for these learning processes, lots of conditions. For example, in this case, if Fred Flintstone had seen a bird go into the bush and die, he would probably not have applied it to himself. So these kinds of, this indirect learning only works when the role model actually, when you can identify with the role model. And the last one I'll show is reflective learning, which is the ability to think back on what you did last Saturday, or 2 years ago, last Saturday, when you could still go out, for example, and then think, oh, maybe I shouldn't have done that, or what should I do differently next time? And these learning processes evolved over time. So the habituation one, the first one I showed, basically getting used to the fact that some things in your environment are irrelevant. Already amoebas have that. Like one-celled organisms can already habituate to stuff in their environment. But reflective learning, the last one, as far as we know, only humans have that. Only humans have autobiographical memory and can look back, reflect on their past sins, and then try to change their behavior. So these evolved over time, and these are, as far as we know, how organisms can learn. Which means that in any behavior change environment, if you want to change a decision maker's decisions, if you want to make sure an implementer implements your intervention, if you want to make sure coaches do anything differently, this is what you'll have to use. One or more of these 9 learning processes. But they're also super fundamental. It's very hard to think about how to use those. And because of that, in psychological research, we usually use behavior change methods. And those methods implement one or more of those evolutionary learning processes. There's one, for example, called planning coping responses, and that uses procedural memory and reflective learning to help people change their behavior. And these methods, they have a little description, like a recipe. In this case, for example, what you do is that you sit together with somebody, for example. You identify barriers to whatever they want to do. And then you think about how they could deal with those barriers. It's not rocket science. And we found out that actually that doesn't work very well if you don't practice the response with people. So that's one of those conditions that you need to satisfy for it to be effective. So we have loads of those methods. There's this open access article where we have 99 of those behavior change methods that you can use. So then the question is, how do you figure out which of those 99 methods you actually use? Because if you talk to people about why they do what they do, and this again is an example from my research, so it's about substance use, about MDMA, specifically using a high dose, these are the kinds of answers you get. So people wonder whether if they use a high dose, they can connect to others better, or what their friends think they should do, or if they use a high dose, they get more energy or not. Whether their friends use a high dose, whether they are even able to determine their dose accurately. If you don't get your ecstasy tested, obviously you don't know the dose. Whether they will still remember everything, etc. Basically, these are just very simple considerations. This is the kind of answers you get from people when you talk to them about why they do what they do. So the question is, how do you map this to those behavior change methods? And for that, again, we have theories. Theories basically say, we take a bunch of those considerations people have, and because they satisfy this criterion, they are the same determinant. So if stuff is about advantages or disadvantages of behavior, we call it attitude. If stuff is about what other people think or do, we call it perceived norms. If stuff is about whether you think you can do the behavior, we call it self-efficacy. And then the trick is that those determinants constructs are combined with other constructs in what is basically a theory. So this is something called the reasoned action approach or the theory of planned behavior, which says that if a behavior is reasoned, then people's intention predicts whether they will engage in the behavior. And that intention is predicted by their attitude, norms, and self-efficacy. And then these determinants you can use to look up the methods that you can use to change those. So this intervention mapping book and the article I just showed that we can send around if people want it, have lists of these methods organized by determinant. Because, of course, the bits of people's psychology you want to change determine the ways you can use to change those. There are loads of those determinants, and each of those determinants consists of loads of subdeterminants. So basically, in this intervention mapping process, you spend a lot of time actually figuring out why your target population does or doesn't do what they should or shouldn't do. So that basically fits there in the middle, the subdeterminants and the determinants. So that means that that blue box, that's kind of the bit I explained right now, but that blue box also applies to the green boxes at the top. So what you do here, mapping out these determinants and subdeterminants, in other words, figuring out why people do or don't do what they do or don't do, you do that both for the target population individual, but also for everybody in the environment in control of something that is important for the target behavior. So if an organization has to implement procedures to make it easier to notify others of something that went wrong or whatever, somebody's in control of those procedures in the organization, so you have to figure out why those people would or would not implement those procedures. And if you have implementers who at an organization have to make sure that every year money is budgeted to make sure that an intervention is applied and that there are discussions with coaches or whoever that they have to do something, then those implementers, adopters, maintainers also have to take specific actions, and they again have determinants and subdeterminants for doing or not doing those things. So that's the idea. Basically, you always try to understand why people do or don't do what they do or don't do, and you use psychological theory to help you obtain this understanding. So the idea is that you have an intervention. The intervention works because it implements one or more of those behavior change methods that we know is how people learn. Then it can change one or more determinants, or rather it changes those specific subdeterminants that you target. And then hopefully at the right moment, the right signal will be sent to somebody's central nervous system and to their muscles, so they perform the right behavior, so they are happier and healthier. So the protocol is centered around this little model. So you start with the needs assessment, where you map out what actually the problem is. Then you analyze the determinants. Then you look at those methods and applications about how to change those determinants. Then you wrap it all together in your intervention. And then you have the two special steps that you do from the beginning, the implementation and the evaluation. And then usually after the evaluation, you learn a lot more about the problem and how to address it. So generally you'll want to start over and keep iterating so that you can keep improving the intervention. Throughout these, the idea is that it's very important to realize that even though changing individuals is the key to changing everything, every individual is in an environment. So you never only focus on the individuals. You always have to take into account how does their environment look, which other actors are there, which what do we have to take into account. And you use the core processes to answer all your questions, which are brainstorming, looking for empirical evidence by other people, combining theory, doing new research to find out what specifically is important in your target population, and then continuing until you have the right answers. This is, in practice, it's quite an iterative process. You don't actually go through these steps in this order all the time. You just get all the information and then you try to find answers. And it's important to realize that it's quite often necessary to go to your target population. Never assume that you know the answers already, because you're usually wrong. So the idea in the needs assessment is that you map out your problem and you collect your planning group. And a planning group should contain everybody who has some expertise that's relevant to your problem. Then you develop the logic model of the problem, which basically tells you what actually the problem is and which environmental conditions are important. And then as a result, you can formulate your program goals. Then you do what we call the flip, where you go from the program goals, which are usually about the undesirable bits, you go to what you want to change, what you want, what the desirable behavior should be. And there you start mapping out those performance objectives, those are the sub-behaviors, and the environmental conditions and the determinants. You summarize all this in a so-called matrix of change objectives, which summarizes who does what with the sub-behaviors in the rows, and the specific so-called change objectives, the specific bits that will need to be in your intervention, in the cells, organized by determinant in the columns. And this is convenient because, as I explained earlier, the behavior change methods are also organized by determinants in the book and that open access article. So once you organized everything you learned about why people do or don't do that desired behavior in these matrices of change objectives, it's quite easy to start looking for methods that you can use to change those. So in step two, you basically build this. You build like a little logic model of the problem, and you often have multiple sub-behaviors and of course more determinants and loads more sub-determinants and some environmental condition, but this is kind of the idea. After step two, ideally, you mapped out completely why people do or don't do your target behavior. And then in step three, you move a bit to the left and you start thinking about how can you actually change those things. So those are those behavior change methods or behavior change principles. And those are always theoretical principles, so they are very in specific applications, which is how your intervention will look. And those can, of course, be wildly different depending on your target population, the culture, the kind of means you have available, whether you have the availability of somebody to do a training or whether you have to make billboards or something. Of course, that determines how your actual applications look. And then in step four, you integrate it all into a program and you start overseeing the people who create the program, which are people from like an advertising agency or copywriters. And that can be quite hard because they often also have ideas about how behavior change works and with varying amounts of expertise in that area. Then you pretest, preferably in small little bits. So you can ideally pretest little bits of your intervention with your target population. So you can do it qualitatively, talk to them and see whether they like it, whether they would even use it. Or you can also look at whether the little bits of your intervention manage to change the determinants or sub-determinants that they were designed to change. And then you eventually have your intervention. And then steps 5 and 6 are a bit special because you already start anticipating on them from the beginning. The unfortunate truth with intervention development is that if you have a nice intervention, only a subset of the people who should adopt it adopt it, then only a subset actually implement it for the longer term, and in the even longer term, only a very small percentage maintains the intervention. So it's important to anticipate on this sad reality by thinking from the beginning of what those people should do to make sure they maintain it and to try to stimulate that they do this. And one of the ways is to make sure that you include stakeholders in the planning group, which basically means that you do everything again, but for those stakeholders. Well, and then you mapped this whole thing out, and then you start thinking about how to evaluate these things, which basically means that you try to evaluate all those little boxes. Whether every sub-determinant changed, whether every sub-behavior changed, whether the environmental conditions changed. And then you know which bits worked better and which bits worked slightly less well. So that means you know what to improve next time. So this is basically just a scientific study. So that's the part where you have a lot of expertise usually available, not necessarily yourself, but there are clear people like statisticians who you can involve for this. So in that sense, this is the easiest bit once you did everything in the beginning properly. So that's basically the bird's eye overview of intervention mapping. You start with needs assessment, determinant analysis. Then you think about how to change things. Then you implement it in intervention. And all the while you anticipate on implementation and evaluation. That's it. Thank you for your attention.